Audible Studios presents Teach Like a Champion 2.0, 62 Techniques That Put Students on the Path to College, written by Doug Lemov and Norman Atkins, performed by Neil Hellegers.
Introduction: The Art of Teaching and Its Tools. Great teaching is an art. In the other arts, painting, sculpture, the writing of novels, great masters leverage a proficiency with basic tools to transform the rawest of materials, stone, paper, ink, into the most valued assets in society. This alchemy is all the more astounding because the tools often appear unremarkable to others. Who would look at a chisel, a mallet, and a file and imagine them producing Michelangelo's David? Great art relies on the mastery and application of foundational skills, learned through diligent study, craftsmanship, if you will. You learn to strike a chisel with a mallet and refine the skill with time, learning at what angle to strike the chisel and how tightly to hold it. Someday, perhaps years later, observers may assess the philosophy expressed by what you create. But far more important than any theory is your proficiency with the lowly chisel. True, not everyone who learns to drive a chisel will create a David. But neither can anyone who fails to master the tool do much more than make marks on rocks. Every artist, teachers included, is an artisan whose task is to study a set of tools and unlock the secrets of their use. A chisel appears mundane, but the more you understand it, the more it guides you to see what is possible. Rounding a contour with unexpected smoothness, the chisel causes you to realize, suddenly, that you could bring added subtlety to a facial expression, more tension to the muscles of the figure you are sculpting, and this changes your vision for it. Mastery of tools does not just allow creation, it informs it. The process is often far from glamorous. An artist's life is a tradesman's life, really, characterized by calluses and stone dust, requiring diligence and humility. But its rewards are immense. It is a worthy life's work. Traveling abroad during my junior year in college, I saw Picasso's school notebooks on display at the Picasso Museum in Barcelona. What I remember best are the sketches filling the margins of his pages. These weren't sketchbooks, mind you. These were notebooks like those every student keeps of notes from lectures. The tiny sketches memorialized a teacher's face or Picasso's own hand grasping a pencil, with perfect perspective, line, and shading. I had always thought Picasso's work was about abstraction, about a way of thinking that rendered the ability to draw accurately and realistically irrelevant. His sketches told another story, bearing witness to his mastery of fundamentals and constant drive to refine his skills. Even in the stray moments of his schooling, he was honing the building blocks of his technique. He was an artisan first, and then an artist, as the fact that he filled, by one count, 178 sketchbooks in his life further attests. This book is about the tools of the teaching craft. More specifically, it's about the tools necessary for success in the most important part of the field, teaching in public schools, primarily those in the inner city, that serve students born to poverty and, too often, a rapidly closing window of opportunity. The price of failure there is high and the challenges immense. Teachers there often work in a crucible where our society's failures are paramount and self-evident, and sometimes seem nearly overwhelming. Still, every day in every neighborhood on the near or the far edge of hope, there are teachers who, without much fanfare, take the students who others say can't read great literature, can't do algebra or calculus, can't and don't want to learn, and turn them into scholars who can. Impossibly, we often don't know who those teachers are, but they are everywhere. Generally laboring unnoticed down the hall from one of the 50% of new hires in urban districts who leave teaching within their first 3 years. Think about that. It turns out for these struggling new teachers, solutions to the challenges that will ultimately drive them out of the profession flourish just a few yards away. It turns out that for students, Walking into the right classroom can pry the doors of opportunity back open. The problem is that we aren't serious enough about learning from the teachers who can provide these answers. Consider Zenaida Tan, whom Jason Felch of the Los Angeles Times profiled in 2010, after data culled from the Los Angeles Unified School District revealed that over a seven-year period, Tan had been one of the top handful of teachers in the city, her students making dramatically larger gains than those of the average teacher year after year. By the LAUSD's measure, Felch wrote, Tan simply meets standard performance, as virtually all district teachers do. Evaluators' only other option is below standard performance. On a recent evaluation, her principal checked off all the appropriate boxes, Tan said, then noticed she had been late to pick up her students from recess three times. I threw it away because I got upset, Tan said. Why don't you focus on my teaching? Why don't you focus on where my students are? My goal was to find as many such teachers as I could and honor them by focusing on and studying their teaching. To write this book, I spent a lot of time standing in the back of classrooms and watching videotape of great teachers in action. I used Jim Collins' observation from Built to Last and Good to Great that what separates great from good matters more than what describes mere competence. I wanted to know not what made a teacher pretty good, but what made her exceptional, able to beat the odds. What made certain teachers able to achieve what 1,000 well-intentioned social programs could not? Were there consistent ideas that allowed them to more reliably transform lives? Were there words and actions the rest of us could copy and adapt? Were there general trends to provide a roadmap, principles behind the excellence? Or was their excellence idiosyncratic and unmappable? What I found was that while each great teacher is unique, as a group, their teaching held elements in common. I started to see both theme and variation, so I began to make a list of the things they did. I gave those actions names so I could remember them, and over time my list grew in both the number of topics and the level of specificity. Ideas coalesced into techniques. Not every teacher I observed used every technique I described. Like Felch, I found that great teachers came in every stripe and style. They were quiet and animated, smiling and stern. Some stuck to the basics, while others veered far from the district's often rigid curriculum. But in the aggregate, a story emerged. There is a toolbox for closing achievement gaps, it turns out. The contents have been forged by 10,000 teachers working quietly, and usually without recognition, at the end of cracked linoleum hallways. I am sure that some of my analysis of what they do is wrong. In fact, I have rewritten this book from the original to try to capture more of what they do with better accuracy. The pages that follow are my effort to describe and organize their tools and how they use them. If you're a teacher near the beginning of your study of the craft of teaching, my aim is to help you become one of those teachers who, for a long and distinguished career, unlocks the latent talent and skill waiting in students, no matter how many previous efforts have been unsuccessful. If you commit yourself and your talents to this work, you deserve to be successful and to change lives. If you are successful, you will most likely be happy in the work, and when you are happy, in turn, you will do better work. If you are a master teacher already, I hope a discussion of tools and their applications, the framing of a vocabulary for talking about the critical and sometimes overlooked moments of your day, will inspire you not only to refine your craft, but also to love doing so, and to feel the pleasure of committing or recommitting to the deepest possible mastery of the complex and worthy endeavor that is your life's work. I assume that in many cases this book may describe things you already know and do. That's great by me, and in that case, my goal is to help you get a little better at them, perhaps seeing useful applications and variations you hadn't considered. Either way, your growth is at least as important as that of a novice teacher. Teaching is the best and most important work in our society. Those who do it deserve to experience constant growth and learning. That, after all, is what we wish for our students. If you lead a school, I hope this book will help you in helping teachers do this challenging work as successfully as possible. In our field, the first obligation of an organization is to help its people succeed. When teachers end the day with a sense of accomplishment, when they feel they are both successful and growing more so, they stay in our schools for a long time, do outstanding work, work joyfully, and inspire others, and thus pay the organization back in spades. Let me say, though, with a humility that is reinforced every time I observe a champion teacher at work, that I am no master. Far from it. My work has not been to invent the tools I describe here, but to explain how others use them and what makes them effective. This has meant putting names on techniques in the interest of helping create a common vocabulary with which to analyze and discuss the classroom. The names may seem like a gimmick at first, but they are one of the most important parts. If there were no word democracy, it would be 1,000 times harder to have and sustain a thing called democracy. We would forever be bogged down in inefficiency. You know, that thing we talked about where everyone gets a say? At exactly the moment we needed to take action, teachers and administrators must be able to talk quickly and efficiently with colleagues about a clearly defined and shared set of ideas in order to sustain their work. They need a shared vocabulary thorough enough to allow a comprehensive analysis of events that happen in a classroom. I believe that names matter and are worth using. Ideally, they will allow you to talk about your own teaching and that of your peers in efficient, specific language. But I want to be clear. Despite the names, what appears here is neither mine, especially, nor a theory. It is a set of field notes from observations of the work of masters, some of whom you will meet in this book, and many others whom you will not, but whose diligence and skill informed and inspired this work. What is 2.0? What, you might ask, does the 2.0 in the title of this book signify? If you've read the original, Teach Like a Champion, you might ask, why not just update the original and keep the name the same? The addition of the phrase 2.0 acknowledges that the book is so full of new ideas, within a different structure, that it is hard for me to think of it as the same book. Over the past 4 years, I have learned as much from watching great teachers in action as in the time it took me to write the original version of the book, if not more. In that time, I have been inspired by what talented and motivated teachers do with a useful idea when they find it. True, they use it, of course, often to inspirational effect, but almost right away, great teachers start to adapt and adjust anything good. They make it fit with their own unique style and approach, their setting and students. Most of all, it turns out, the best teachers find ways to take anything you give them and make it more rigorous. Almost as soon as I began to share the ideas I'd gleaned from teachers in the original version of this book, the guidance became obsolete. I began to see the ideas reflected back at me in the classrooms of teachers, but adapted, tweaked, and improved, so that what I was seeing when teachers executed the techniques from the book was often better than what I described. I came to call this process the virtuous cycle. Give teachers a good thing, and they make it better, smarter, faster. They make you wonder how you didn't think of something so obviously good or nuanced the first time around. This, to me, is the most inspiring part of the profession, and why I am deeply optimistic about teaching. Nothing could make me happier than to be confronted by the obsolescence of the original ideas, and to think about how soon this second version of the book will need further updating. For now, the new title reflects the depth of knowledge this cycle has generated. As I will outline later, Teach Like a Champion 2.0 also includes brand new techniques. This is because great teachers are entrepreneurs, and teaching is full of what Deborah Ball, Dean of the School of Education at the University of Michigan, calls endemic problems. Endemic, in this case, is the opposite of exotic. It means problems that are entirely predictable. We know they're going to happen. Endemic questions include those such as, what do you do when a student gives up and simply won't try? How do you know what the student who hides silently in the corner is learning? How can you maximize the amount of work students are doing? And what do you do when you ask a student to sit down and he smirks and tells you to sit down? As these examples suggest, the predictability of endemic problems does not imply that they are simple to solve. And it shouldn't take a dozen years of brutal trial and error, suffering, and fatigue for a teacher to figure out these problems. Further observation has helped me to see the many endemic problems for which teachers have derived brilliant solutions. The degree of these additions, too, argued for a book that was 2.0, as much sequel as revision. On teachers and the advice they get. Teachers are drowning in advice. Most of the time, they are tasked with executing ideas and directives that come from elsewhere, from people who don't actually teach every day. Perhaps as a result, many of those ideas and directives are disconnected from the challenges that shape a teacher's daily work. They are often developed for purposes other than mastering the mundane, to some, endemic challenges of teaching. And this tends to exacerbate the wide range of guidance teachers receive. It's worth asking, then, what advice should look like. I think of guidance as coming in three varieties: ideology-driven, research-driven, and data-driven. Ideology-driven guidance represents the most common form of advice teachers receive. From time immemorial, people have thought of things that could or should happen in classrooms and proceed to tell teachers to do them. This kind of guidance tends to say, "This is what a classroom should be like," which is problematic even if you agree with the idea in question. A teacher might be told that a classroom should be democratic, for example, and perhaps given some parameters for what a democratized classroom should look like. But such a classroom is not assessed for whether student achievement rose, but whether the teacher did what the democratizing guidance described. Assessment of the effectiveness of an ideology is usually self-reinforcing. Teachers in such cases are asked not to use and adapt ideas as they see fit to get to a few important outcomes, student achievement in a given area, say, but rather to assess results by checking off a growing list of musts. Teachers must teach English, math, science, history, the arts, banking and financial literacy, environmental stewardship, entrepreneurship, and personal hygiene, in a technology-rich environment that builds self-esteem, seats students in pods, provides multiple solutions to every problem, avoids teacher talk, and never exposes a student to a page of text that has more than 5 vocabulary words he or she doesn't know. Please don't forget the anti-drug unit. In other words, ideology-based guidance contributes to the development of schools where teachers are always trying to do lots of things that people are telling them to do, instead of using their insight, problem-solving abilities, and a wide array of tools to achieve specific goals. The result, often, is an administrator with a checklist. Gradually, the guidance that teachers receive has begun to be more research-driven. Research matters, so that's a step in the right direction, but there are still problems. Research needs to be distilled and digested for application. If research supports a particular action, does that mean you should always perform that action to the exclusion of everything else? Or should you combine it with other things? How often, in what settings, and with what other actions? And how do you meld them? Even if you nailed all those questions, the research might not prove effective until you'd figured out the details of implementing it in, say, 46 minutes on Tuesday morning with 31 fourth graders of widely varying skill levels. Or it might not be of any value at all. There's a lot of research out there of varying quality, and even the useful parts are interpreted with a mix of good sense, cautious fidelity, outright distortion, and blind orthodoxy. This can result in research justifying poor teaching as easily as good. Research, in other words, works best when it is a tool, not a mandate, adapted and applied by professionals to achieve a specific goal, and then assessed to determine whether and how it helps them meet that goal. This brings up the third type of advice for teachers: data-driven guidance. Data-driven guidance is based not on what should happen, but on what did happen when success was achieved. How were all the ideas and research knitted together and executed so as to survive their encounter with 28 moderately skeptical 7th graders? What else had to happen to achieve that singular triumph? What were the themes and variations teachers employed across multiple successful lessons, considering their own personality, setting, and context? It's not simple, this data-driven guidance, and it has pitfalls of its own. But as you have probably guessed, this book is an effort to bring that kind of guidance to teachers, based on the work of those peers who successfully solve endemic problems. To paraphrase a wise colleague, the only thing I know for sure about my effort at offering data-driven guidance is that I got some of it wrong. Surely, when one of the teachers I was watching did the thing that drove her results, I was looking in the other direction, misunderstanding what she'd done, confusing cause for effect, or seeing what I wanted to see at least some of the time. But one of the great things about data-driven guidance is that anyone can seek it out. Even if you disagree with my conclusions, whether you are a teacher or a leader in charge of a school district, a state, or a nation, you can use a data-driven approach to take your best shot at measuring the outcome you think most valuable, finding its best practitioners, and inferring guidance from their work. One major benefit of a data-driven approach is that it generates its knowledge from teachers. It's the process of showing teachers a picture of themselves at their very best. As a result, it considers teachers not just as recipients and implementers of the field's knowledge, but as creators of it. Problem solvers, entrepreneurs, generators of the professional insight. It makes teachers intellectuals. That, I think, really matters. It not only honors teachers and teaching, but ideally also changes the perception of the field and the stature of the work. We often talk about the achievement gap, but really there are many. The gap between rich and poor, true, but also the gap between what students think and what they can write. The gap between schools in our nation and the best school systems in the world. And the gap between what our schools offer and what they could be. One of the key messages of this book is that solutions to teaching's achievement gaps exist. There is no gap that has not been closed already by some teacher somewhere. We are not suffering from a lack of solutions, so much as our failure to learn from teachers who have generated insight and put their ideas to work. Specific, concrete, actionable techniques. When I was a young teacher, I'd go to trainings and leave with lofty words ringing in my ears. They touched on everything that had made me want to teach. Have high expectations for your students. Expect the most from students every day. Teach kids, not content. I'd be inspired, ready to improve, until I got to school the next day. I'd find myself thinking, well, how do I do that? What's the action I should take at 8:25 a.m. to demonstrate those raised expectations? What ultimately helped me improve my teaching was when a peer told me something very concrete like, when you want them to follow your directions, stand still. If you're walking around passing out papers, it looks like the directions are no more important than all of the other things you're doing. Show that directions matter. Stand still. Over time, it was this sort of concrete, specific, actionable advice, far more than reminders I must have high expectations, that allowed me to raise expectations in my classroom. My approach in this book reflects that experience. I have tried to describe the techniques of champion teachers in a concrete, specific, and actionable way that allows you to start using them tomorrow. I chose to call these tools techniques and not strategies, even though the teaching profession tends to use the latter term. Because to me, a strategy is a generalized approach that informs decisions, whereas a technique is a thing you say or do in a particular way. If you are a sprinter, your strategy might be to get out of the blocks fast and run from the front. Your technique would be to incline your body forward at about 5 degrees as you drive your legs up and out ahead of you. If you wanted to be a great sprinter, practicing and refining that technique would help you achieve more than refining your strategy. And because a technique is an action, the more you practiced it, the better you'd get. Mulling over your decision to run from the front 100 times doesn't make you any better. Practicing 100 sprints with just the right body position does. This is why I think focusing on honing and improving specific techniques is the fastest route to success. My hope is that, with practice, you'll be able to walk to the front of any classroom and use cold call, Technique 33 in Chapter 7, and no opt-out, Technique 11 in Chapter 3, to hold your students accountable in a lesson with positive framing, Technique 58 in Chapter 12, and a high ratio, Chapters 7, 8, and 9. Mastering those techniques will be far more productive than being firm of convictions, committed to a strategy, and in the end, beaten by the reality of what lies inside the classroom door in the toughest neighborhoods of our cities and towns. It's also worth noting that this set of techniques is not a system. For me, the benefit of considering individual techniques is that they are small, discrete units of inquiry. You can choose something that interests you and study it, improving quickly and seeing the results. And you can incorporate a new technique into what you already do without having to redesign your entire approach or buying into everything in the book. As Chip and Dan Heath point out in their book, Switch, how people encounter useful information has a lot to do with whether they are successful in using it to change and improve their lives. Oftentimes, what we conclude is resistance to change, by teachers, say, is in fact lack of clarity about what concrete thing to do next to begin the change. Okay, I get that I should be more rigorous, but how do I do that, or start to do that in a concrete, manageable way? Giving people very small ideas to try might seem less efficient than giving them an overarching system that encompasses everything they do. But trying to do everything at once is a recipe for a lack of action. Having a manageable, focused idea to work on can help make change and improvement safe and easy to pursue, with the result that the technique becomes part of your life. We often achieve more change over the long run via small changes in the short run. Another key observation from Switch is that we tend to assume that the size of a solution must match the size of the problem. You were observed, there were criticisms, it seems you have to make wholesale changes to everything you do. Or do you? Often, very small changes can have large and profound effects on big problems. I have a friend who struggled for years with his weight, wrestling to make huge changes in his lifestyle, with immense effort that drew his focus away from work and family. One day, he realized that an aching tooth had been keeping him from chewing food on one side of his mouth. He would push the food to the other side and gulp it down half-chewed. He realized that this might be causing him to overeat. He had the tooth pulled and lost 10 pounds in a few weeks. Teaching can be similar. Our mascot on the Uncommon Schools Teach Like a Champion team is Mighty Mouse. Little things, we like to remind ourselves, can have big muscles. The irony of what works. Many of the techniques you will read about in this book may at first seem mundane, unremarkable, even disappointing. They are not always especially innovative. They are not always intellectually startling. They sometimes fail to march in step with educational theory, but they work. As a result, they yield an outcome that more than compensates for their occasionally humble appearance. There's evidence of the effectiveness of these tools and the overwhelming success not only of the classrooms of teachers from whom I learned them, but in almost every urban school. In those schools, there are usually a few classrooms where the same students who moments before were unruly and surly suddenly take their seats, pull out their notebooks, and, as if by magic, think and work like scholars. In each of those classrooms stands one teacher, an artisan whose attention to technique and execution differentiates her from most of her peers. One of the biggest ironies I hope you will take away from reading this book is that many of the tools likely to yield the strongest classroom results remain essentially beneath the notice of our theories and theorists of education. Consider one unmistakable driver of student achievement: carefully built and practiced routines for the distribution and collection of classroom materials. I often begin teacher trainings by showing a video clip of my colleague, Doug McCurry, the founder of Amistad Academy in New Haven, Connecticut, and the Achievement First Network of Schools, both of which have a national reputation for excellence. In the clip, Doug teaches his students how to pass out papers on the first day or two of school. He takes a minute or so to explain the right way to do it, pass across rows, start in his command, only the person passing gets out of his or her seat if required, and so on. Then his students start to practice. Doug times them with a stopwatch. 10 seconds, pretty good. Let's see if we can get them back out in 8. The students, by the way, are happy as can be. They love to be challenged and love to see themselves improving. They're smiling. See it in action. Clip 48. Watch Doug McCurry encourage his students to pass in their papers faster and faster. Inevitably, there are skeptics when I show this clip. Some argue this isn't what teachers are supposed to be doing during classroom time. They think it's demeaning to ask students to practice banal tasks. The activity treats students like robots, they charge. It brainwashes them when it should be setting their minds free. Now consider those objections in light of the following numbers. Assume that the average class of students passes papers and materials 20 times a day, and that it takes a typical class a minute and 20 seconds to do this. If Doug's students can accomplish this task in just 20 seconds, they will save 20 minutes a day, 1 minute each time. They can then allocate this time to studying the causes of the Civil War or how to add fractions with unlike denominators. Now multiply that 20 minutes per day by 190 school days, and you find that Doug has just taught his students a routine that will net him 3,800 minutes of additional instruction over the course of a school year. That's more than 36 hours or almost 8 additional days of instruction, time for whole units on reconstruction or coordinate geometry. Assuming that Doug spends a total of an hour teaching and practicing this routine, his small investment will yield a return in learning time of roughly 6,000%, setting his students free to engage their minds several thousand times over. Given that time is a school's most precious asset, you could put it another way. Doug has just increased his school's scarcest resource, the time it had already bought in the form of teacher salaries, by about 4%. He has performed a minor miracle. Then combine this manufacture of resources with the ancillary efforts of having strong habits and routines, the self-fulfilling perception of orderliness it gives to the classroom, the routine's capacity to remind students over and over that in this classroom, it is always about doing things, even little things, right, and then better. Now you have a potent technique, one that is common across every one of the highest performing classrooms in schools I have seen. Unfortunately, this dizzyingly effective technique, so efficient, it is all but a moral imperative for teachers to use it, often remains beneath the notice of the avatars of educational theory. Few schools of education stoop to teach aspiring teachers how to train their students to pass out papers, even though it is one of the most valuable things they could possibly do. To be fair to the teachers I've studied, not all, not even most of the techniques are so brass tacks oriented. Many are about issues more common to discourse, boosting the amount of cognitive work students do, for example. But even then, what separates the champions are actions that are granular, specific, far beneath the level of philosophy, and knee-deep in the weeds. Turn and talk is a great example. Done well, this technique is a powerful contributor to a rigorous classroom. Done poorly, it is a boondoggle of wasted time and faux autonomy. The difference again lies in the mundane details of a design that builds on routines much like Doug McCurry's to ensure accountability alongside autonomy. The Art of Using the Techniques. In writing this book, I want to emphasize that the art is in the discretionary application of the techniques. I've tried to help artisans be artists, not because I think the work of teaching can be mechanized or made formulaic. There is a right and wrong time and place for all the tools, and their effective application will always fall to the unique style and vision of great teachers. That, in a word, is artistry. Great teaching is no less great because the teacher systematically mastered specific skills than is David a lesser reflection of Michelangelo's genius because Michelangelo mastered the grammar of the chisel before he created the statue. I believe that given the tools here, teachers will make insightful, independent decisions about how and when to use the techniques of the craft as they go about becoming masters of the art of teaching. You'll find that many of the descriptions of these techniques include see it in action, various techniques you can see by watching video clips. These clips have the potential to help you drive practical and effective classroom results. I chose these for the book because they show great teachers using specific teaching techniques that differentiate the great from the merely good. To maximize the effectiveness of these clips, I suggest that you read the description of the technique, watch the video, and then reflect on your own practice and how you might use the technique. Who are the champions? The organization I work for, Uncommon Schools, is a nonprofit that runs charter schools, good ones, I'm proud to say. And I observe that they are good for the reason most schools are good, because they take teachers and teaching seriously, and strive to focus every decision on serving teachers and increasing student achievement. Two goals that are, if not synonymous, then at least deeply synergistic. But this is not a charter school book. This is a teaching book. A book about the actions inside the classroom, rather than policy decisions outside it. It is important to point out that the teachers from whom I learn the things I have written about here ply their trade in both charter and district schools. It would dishonor those teachers not to emphasize this point. As I sit at my desk, I can recall scrambling to write down the insights I learned in classrooms, district, and charter, from New York to Nashville, not to mention Boston, Houston, and Oakland. As you watch the videos, I hope you will be inspired by the teaching, but you may not always see the diversity in settings in which I learn the techniques those videos demonstrate. One reason for this is eminently practical. Observation is relatively easy. Walking into a classroom with a video camera and asking for the right to use the resulting video no matter what happens is another, and far easier to accomplish in some places than others. Further, video is an incredibly unforgiving medium. Buried in the recesses of our video archives are 1,000 brilliant moments of teaching made unusable as teaching aids by a thunderous sneeze, the stumbling mispronunciation of a key term, or the ringing of the dismissal bell at exactly the wrong moment. The classrooms you see in this book offer the highest quality demonstration of a technique I could find in a classroom with excellent results. In most cases, the amount we learned from the teachers was prodigious. But these classrooms may not be the only or the first ones where my team and I learned about the techniques. The second reason may be more important. Many of the places I have shot most frequently are hubs of the virtuous cycle. Places where teachers were deeply intentional about applying, adapting, and improving the techniques, and willing to invest time in reflecting on that process. They are often places where, more than just having these conversations with me and my team, teachers engaged in conversations with each other, endeavoring to learn, via sustained conversation and dialogue, how to use and adapt the ideas. They taped themselves and each other constantly for inquiry and reflection, so it was easy to share. This often resulted not only in great 2.0 learning, but in great video. Teaching, it turns out, is a team sport, where teachers make each other better fastest by building robust cultures where they study and share insights about their work. Our cameras practically exploded with amazing footage when we taped in such places. Many of them were the schools I am closest to personally, but they are by no means the only places where the techniques flourish, nor are they necessarily the places where they first developed. Defining what works. So how did I identify the teachers I studied and the schools I frequented? And what does it mean to say that they were successful in closing the achievement gap? My primary tool was a basic analysis of state test scores that controlled for poverty. I use this approach to look for positive outliers, teachers whose students came from poverty, and who dealt with the associated challenges such a demographic implied, yet still achieve results comparable to what was achieved by students of privilege. Consider figure I.1. The graph in the figure is of data showing performance on the 2011 sixth grade math test in New York State. At the circled school, about 96% of its students are eligible for free and reduced price lunch, the standard measure of poverty in the education sector. According to the data, schools with similar populations typically saw about 40% of their students pass the state test in 2011. The correlation between poverty and lower achievement is strong in the data, and also shows up in the results of schools without any students at all eligible for free meals. About 83% of their students passed the test. But at the circled school, even more passed the test. Every student passed the test. In fact, although it's not evident from this figure, 60% of students in the school scored advanced, an outcome that placed it in the top 5% of schools in the state, regardless of population. Even more important, The trend continued over time. Sixth graders in the school in 2013 passed the sixth grade test at a rate more than 130% of the statewide average, again despite dramatically higher poverty. And the initially strong results posted by sixth graders in 2011 were sustained. By 2013, this cohort of students passed the eighth grade New York State math assessment at a rate of 74%. This sounds like a significant drop-off, but in fact, the opposite is true. The 2013 scores were post-Common Core, coming after New York redesigned its exams to make them significantly more demanding. Overall, just 28% of students in New York State passed the math test that year. Students at our outlier school passed at a rate more than 2.5 times that of students statewide, despite a poverty rate more than double that of the state average. In short, the school, Troy Preparatory Charter School in Troy, New York, part of the Uncommon Schools Network, and its math teachers, Brian Bellinger, Katie Bellucci, Bridget McElduff, and Anna O'Neill, all of whom you can see in action in this book, deserve study and attention. How do they approach teaching, relationships, lesson planning, and the like? Surely there must be things each of us can take from their classrooms. My goal was to turn up as many outliers like this as possible. Sometimes it was a single classroom, just the sixth grade, say, and sometimes it was an entire school. Whenever possible, I tried to use as much additional data as I could and tried to look for signals that were durable over time. Sustained results, as opposed to one-time blips more likely to be the result of causes other than great teaching. When a school was successful for a long time, I also considered the principal's guidance and input in sourcing teachers. This sounds subjective, I suppose, but it's still useful. Although there are data to suggest that the average principal is only so-so at identifying the best teachers, very good principals are, of course, different from the average. One could argue that the reason they are successful is their ability to understand whose teaching is especially effective. And there are also data to support the idea that although it's hard to differentiate teachers around the middle of the performance curve by watching, the great ones are pretty reliably identifiable by effective administrators. I used administrator input for several reasons. One, data are incredibly important, but they're not always simple to use. Consider the challenge of English language arts, ELA results, which generally speaking take several years to show up. Is it plausible that somewhere an English teacher's breathtaking results were in fact caused by the work of the teacher, or teachers, who came before her, rather than the 6 months she spent with teachers in that year? Asking for a principal's input and securing other data were ways to ensure that decisions were most accurate, testing by confirming data points. Further, in many cases there are very few data about science, social studies, and the arts. So I observe teachers in those areas who were identified by school leaders, whose track record of success in ELA and math was also outstanding. A bit of extrapolation for sure, but better in the end than ignoring those fields entirely. Because my primary measure was state test scores, it's worth addressing some misconceptions about their use, if only to underscore the exemplary quality of the work of the teachers who informed this book. State test results are necessary, but not sufficient. Without doubt, there are myriad skills and a broad knowledge base that students need to master to succeed in college. And many of these things are not measured on state assessments. But also, without doubt, there is a set of core skills that is also necessary, and that many, even most, students not born to privilege have not mastered. They need to be able to read and discuss Shakespeare, but they also need to be able to read a passage they've never seen before and effectively make sense of its meaning, structure, and craft. They need to be able to write a short paragraph giving evidence to support a conclusion. They need to be able to solve for X. Most state tests do an effective job of measuring these skills, and although students who can demonstrate them are not yet fully prepared for college, there are no students who are prepared for college who cannot demonstrate them. It's also worth noting that the teachers who are better at teaching the skills measured on state tests are most often also the teachers who are effective at teaching broader, higher-level skills. Within uncommon schools, when we study the success of our students on tougher internal assessments, essay writing assessments that are far more demanding than state tests, for example, there is a strong correlation between both the teachers and students whose results show the most growth and achievement on the two types. Furthermore, our teachers who achieve the strongest results from state assessments also have the strongest results in ensuring our students' entry into and success in college. In short, student success as measured by state assessments is predictive, not just of their success in getting into college, but of their succeeding there. Finally, the correlation between success on even more straightforward assessments, nationally normed test scores, and ultimate academic success should be instructive to us. I often meet educators who take it as an article of faith that work on basic skills is in tension with higher order thinking. That is, when you teach students to, say, memorize their multiplication tables, you are not only failing to foster more abstract and deeper knowledge, but are actually interfering with it. This is illogical, and is one of the tenets of American education not shared by most of the educational systems of Asia, especially those that are the highest performing public school systems in the world. Those nations are more likely to see that foundational skills like memorizing multiplication tables enable higher order thinking and deeper insight because they free students from having to use up their cognitive processing capacity in more basic calculations. If you are to have the insight to observe that a more abstract principle is at work in a problem, or that there is another way to solve it, you cannot be concentrating on the computation. That part has to happen with automaticity, so that as much of your processing capacity as possible can remain free to reflect on what you're doing. The more proficient you are at lower order skills, the more proficient you can become at higher order skills. With that, I leave you to the champions and their work. Here's a brief map of what's in each chapter. How to use this book. Chapter organization. I've organized this collection of field notes from my observations of highly effective teachers as a how-to book, and divided the techniques into four parts. The ideas behind these parts capture what I think are four core challenges of teaching. Check for understanding, academic ethos, ratio, and behavior and culture. Check for understanding. In the first version of Teach Like a Champion, check for understanding, CFU, was a single technique described with good intentions and insufficient actionable concrete everyday guidance, the thing I care about most. In the first drafts of 2.0, I quickly realized that CFU would need its own chapter. John Wooden, the UCLA basketball coach, who, as some people know, was first an English teacher and continued to see himself as a teacher throughout his storied career as perhaps the greatest coach in the history of American sports, once said the most crucial task of teaching was to distinguish "I taught it" from "they learned it." If there is a better description of CFU, I don't know what it is. Agreeing with Wooden, I decided to make this topic the first chapter so as to capture its importance. However, because we learned so incredibly much about CFU in the ensuing years, a single chapter proved impossible. It took two and earned a section all its own. The 10 techniques in these two chapters are entirely new to the second edition. I did not know they existed 4 years ago, though teachers did, of course. When I look back at footage of lessons I watched in writing the first version, I see that teachers were doing these things over and over. I just failed to see them. Academic ethos. Part 2 of the book, Academic Ethos, is about the importance of seeking the maximum level of academic rigor. It comprises revised versions of 4 chapters from the first version of the book: setting high academic expectations, planning for success, lesson structure, and pacing. Of course, other key factors help determine the level of rigor in a lesson, the content you teach and how deep you go. But these 4 chapters examine concrete actions that build rigor in a variety of domains. If there were a theme to what has happened to the setting high academic expectations techniques in the period after the publication of the first version of this book, it would be toward greater rigor. And the resulting presentation is, I believe, much cleaner and easier to use. It much more clearly tracks, in a chronological way, the key tools and decisions you make in a lesson. Ratio. Part 3 of the book consists of 3 chapters on building ratio, getting students to do as much of the cognitive work as you can. In my brief introduction, I frame the 3 approaches: questioning, writing, and discussion. Differentiate the 2 critical types of ratio that teachers seek, participation ratio and think ratio, and offer one of the most important reflections in the book in the section that I call the content prerequisite. It argues that you cannot successfully cause students to do a great deal of rigorous thinking unless you are also serious about delivering and having students learn lots and lots of content knowledge. Knowledge is what you analyze and think about. Exercises where students try to think deeply about what they know when they in fact know very little may appear high ratio at first, but turn out to be vacuous. Investing directly and substantively in students' base of knowledge, what educators sometimes consider mere factual knowledge, allows them to do applied cognitive work of substance and rigor and independence. But try to do the same tasks without investing in a knowledge base, and you erode their value. Facts and rigor are not opposites, as some educators continue to suggest, but synergistic partners. The necessity of facts and knowledge to thinking, I offer with the humility of retrospect, is the single biggest concept I overlooked or misunderstood in the first edition of this book. In short, please don't read the 3 chapters on ratio without reading the content prerequisite in Chapter 7. Behavior and Culture. Part 4 of the book focuses on behavior and culture. This topic is one that teachers and school leaders who attend our workshops tell us is incredibly useful, because positive culture makes such a difference in everything that happens in a classroom, not least of all academic achievement. Yet there is so precious little guidance on how to build it. And the costs of poor culture are massive. If your classroom culture is not where you want it to be, assessing the effectiveness of discipline, control, management, engagement, and influence is a great first step. I have also tried to frame more clearly in this version of the book 2 critical points teachers must understand in building classroom culture. First, that the purpose of order in the classroom is to promote academic learning. Second, that there is a difference between the power of keeping things from going wrong, which is good, and the benefits of making our classroom a place where things go right, where culture and expectations are positive, joyful, productive, and caring. Put more succinctly, the 2 key framings are, 1, order is necessary but not sufficient to learning, and 2, great culture entails doing far more than just eliminating disruptions. Of course, culture and behavior are not always about control and accountability. I close with Chapter 12 on the power of relationships, ending the book with joy factor. I hope to leave you thinking about the happiness that schooling can be, or should be, and about how powerful a force the joy of not just learning, but schooling is. The structure of the book, 62 core techniques spread out across 12 chapters, allows you to pick and choose techniques in order to improve and master specific aspects of your craft one at a time, and in the order that best suits your teaching. At the same time, the full array of techniques operates in synergy. Using one makes another better, and the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. So I hope you will also find time to read the book through end to end, and push yourself to refine some of the techniques you might not initially choose to focus on. Alternatively, reading the book cover to cover might help you understand more clearly where you want to develop, either because you have talent and strong instincts for a group of techniques, or because you wish you did. As you consider how to use this book, I offer one preliminary reflection on developing people, including yourself. It's easy to slip into a fixing what's wrong mindset with yourself and with others whom you're developing or managing. And although mitigating someone's weaknesses, including your own, can be an effective development strategy, it is also powerful to focus not on fixing what's wrong, but on maximizing what's right. This also applies to the champion teachers I've observed in the course of my work. They too have weaknesses in their teaching, despite their results. What often makes them exceptionally successful, or a core group of skills they are exceptionally good at. It's plausible that developing what you're already good at could improve your teaching just as much as working on your weaknesses. Although even more likely is that a combination of the two would yield the best outcomes. Regardless, you might be tempted to skip a chapter because you already feel that you are effective at the topic it discusses. But I encourage you to study that chapter with special attentiveness, specifically because you are good at those techniques. A bit of refinement could be something you quickly and intuitively apply and that could make you exceptional, or more exceptional. In other words, invest in your strengths, too. How to use this book. Additional features. Beyond the organizational structure of the book, there are a handful of features that can help you get the most out of your time by highlighting and making more accessible certain techniques. They are video clips. If you own the print book edition of Teach Like a Champion, you'll find a DVD containing videos of champion teachers masterfully utilizing the techniques in their own classroom. For access to online videos for both print, ebooks, and audiobooks, visit How to Access the Video Contents near the end of the book and see the instructions on creating an account using your unique PIN. See it in action. Sometimes it's just better to see a teacher use a technique in a classroom than try to picture it. Throughout the book, See It in Action boxes encourage you to learn from champion teachers during exemplary moments by coupling video with brief analysis. Want more? Techniques in practice are about as varied as the teachers who use them. Want more boxes try to eliminate some of the mystery by presenting different takes on a number of techniques. Sidebars. Several ideas that were techniques in the first version of the book are still here, but are discussed in a sidebar and are not numbered as a technique. I did this to try to build more of an implicit hierarchy into the book. Throughout the book, I've used sidebars more extensively to 1. Include additional guidance on existing techniques, 2. Share brand new ideas never discussed in version 1.0, or 3. Repackage a 1.0 technique in a more standalone setting. Reflection and practice. Part of our job as teachers is to be constantly learning. Reflection and practice questions at the end of each chapter provide time and space to pause and examine your own teaching, as well as how you might effectively leverage champion techniques in your classroom. Useful tools. At the end of each chapter, you'll find artifacts to support your implementation of the techniques in your classroom and within your school. Many of the tools are located only on the companion website, www.teachlikeachampion.com, so please be sure to access the documents there. You'll be able to download and modify these tools to fit your particular needs. To access these, visit How to Access the Video Contents near the end of the book and see the instructions on creating an account using your unique PIN. Beyond the book. Beyond the book, there are more ways to engage with a global community of educators who are using this work in their daily lives. Please join the Teach Like a Champion community through our website, www.teachlikeachampion.com. Website. The site serves as the main forum for continuing the conversations and sharing insights on all things Teach Like a Champion through my Field Notes blog. My team and I also share fantastic free resources on this site, ready to be downloaded and tailored to fit your needs. These include lesson materials, practice activities, student work samples, classroom snapshots, and mini training materials. You'll also find information about our workshops, as well as our online training modules, called plug-and-plays. Version 1.0 outtakes. One of the hardest things of revising Teach Like a Champion was dropping things that were important and useful in order to make room for things that were more so. I realize that for some readers, those sections will be sorely missed. For this reason, the website will include a section where key content from the first version remains accessible. One of the sections I suspect readers will miss most is the series of chapters on reading. These I will continue to refine, update, and revise in anticipation of a separate book on the topic, Reading Reconsidered. In the meantime, the older versions of the reading material will live at www.teachlikeachampion.com. To access outtake material, simply sign into your library at teachlikeachampion.com/your library/. Social media. Here's where you can find the Teach Like a Champion team and me through the major social media channels. www.facebook.com/teachlikeachampion, www.twitter.com/teachlikeachamp, www.twitter.com/Doug_Lemov. Chapter 1. Gathering Data on Student Mastery. There are two primary ways students can gather data on student mastery: through questioning and through observation. You teach something, and then you ask students questions, listening for the stream of data within their answers, often engineering your questions so the data stream is a little richer. Alternately, you assign students a task to complete on their own and watch intentionally as they work, attending to what you observe and how to ensure that information about mastery is reliably visible. In either case, a few straightforward techniques can help you find and use data that come from your interactions with students. The first step in increasing the data your questioning reveals is to avoid a common pitfall: using a yes or no question to ask students whether or not they understand. I don't know many teachers, myself included, who haven't said something like the following. Teacher: okay, those are the basics of cellular structure. Everyone clear on the differences between plant and animal cells? Or, teacher: so that's cellular structure and the differences between plant and animal cells. Got it, guys? Technique 1. Reject self-report. Replace functionally rhetorical questions with more objective forms of impromptu assessment. Such questions are usually greeted with silent assent or perhaps a muttered, yeah. Next, the teacher usually says something like this. Teacher: good. Let's push on to the role of chloroplasts. Whether they're addressed to adults or kids, in a school, work, or athletic setting, questions like, is everyone clear on, or everybody got it, are functionally rhetorical. They're asked over and over. The question is almost always a passive yes, and it is almost never accurate. Volumes of social science literature have established that self-report is highly unreliable. Questions that ask for binary, that is, yes-no, answers are particularly suspect. Throw in group dynamics in the classroom, and for the great majority of self-report questions, what we get back isn't really even an answer so much as a formality. Whether people understand or not, they almost always say they do, particularly in groups. The result is we get little, if any, data at a moment when our instincts are telling us we should be assessing. Let's go back to the earlier question. So that cellular structure and the differences between plant and animal cells. Got it, guys? Even if people thought the question was in earnest, most would be reticent to stop a group of 25 people and say, no, actually I don't really understand what you mean by the rigid structure of plant cells. Even if they could, in that moment, 1, identify that there was something they didn't know, and 2, describe it quickly so that you can understand it, most people would be unlikely to do so in front of a group that size, out of embarrassment or fear that they would co-opt the better interests of the group. They'd assume they were the only one who didn't get it and that it wasn't fair to speak up. Even more compelling than implicit social pressure is a deeper problem. Often students don't know that they missed something because, well, they missed it. If they miss your description of the rigid structure of plant cells, they may not know they missed it. Similarly, students often think they understand when they don't, or they don't know how to reflect much on the question of whether they really understand something. When you ask, "Do you understand the differences between the structures of plant and animal cells?" what your students may be assenting to is, for all practical purposes, "Can you think of something you know about the difference between plant and animal cells?" The vague nature of most self-report questions exacerbates this. If our questions aren't directive, they have no reason to draw students' attention to the many things they should know. This encourages them not only to give us false positives, but, possibly, to believe them themselves. Finally, the way we often ask these questions, with a wait time of a fraction of a second, a willingness to accept silent assent without testing, a look of relief even when we get silent assent because we really just want the green light to move on, intimates very clearly that we're not expecting a response. Students know not to speak up. If they do, our response can also send the message that they really weren't supposed to answer. A teacher might offer a perfunctory recap in response to a student who says, "No, actually, I don't get it." "Well, David, do you remember their shape from when we looked at them under the microscope? They had a rectangular pattern. Do they pretty much all look the same? Got it now?" This isn't a message of, "Thank you for that useful data. Let's go back to that." So much as a message of, "Here's what you missed, David." I'll discuss the cultural implications of the messaging around what it means to be an error to a greater extent in Chapter 2. But for now, all David knows is that he was supposed to give his assent and didn't. He'll do better next time. Champion teachers, then, strive to reject self-report as often as they can. They strive to replace moments when they ask for it with a quick series of carefully chosen questions directed at a strategic sample of the class, intended to meaningfully demonstrate student understanding in a minute or less. The trouble with asking, "Got it?" You might be asking, does this mean I can never ask my students, "Got it?" or "Are you ready to go on?" The answer is no. You will assuredly say it sometimes, and doing so is no sin. It's almost impossible to root out such familiar rhetorical habits from your interactions with people. And if you did, it would probably feel unnatural. However, it's powerful and important to recognize how often we use self-report and how often it is functionally rhetorical. When we ask self-report questions, it's in part because we are acknowledging that we have reached a natural transition point. We have come to a spot where we should check in with students and find out how they are doing. Ironically, asking rhetorically squanders that moment and can actually be counterproductive. Over time, if I ask questions that my students come to realize are not really genuine, if I ask and don't really want answers, the effect may be for students to generalize and assume that many of my questions are perfunctory. It's critical that students feel comfortable sharing their knowledge, or the gaps in it, in the classroom. Making a habit of asking questions that you don't really want people to answer can result in their disengaging at exactly the moment you need them to think deeply, or take the risk of sharing an incipient thought. A look at self-monitoring. I've also watched teachers use a method of check for understanding, CFU, that at first glance may seem similar to self-report, self-monitoring. Unlike self-report, however, self-monitoring is very useful, so it's worth reviewing the differences between self-report and self-monitoring and exploring how, and maybe when, to encourage the latter. Developing self-awareness through self-monitoring. In a recent review of spelling words, Amy Youngman of Aspire ERES Academy in Oakland, California, said to her students, "At the end, we're going to vote on a scale of 1 to 4 about how confident we feel about taking our test tomorrow, so be thinking about that as you practice the words." You might ask, isn't this just a fancy version of self-report? One where you ask students to evaluate their own level of understanding? Not quite. Amy, at the moment she says this, is also gathering objective data, quickly scanning and assessing her students' answers. She asks for their self-reflections not to assess their level of mastery, it's too unreliable for that, but to develop their own self-awareness, their skill, and their desire to think about whether they are approaching mastery. She advises them, "If you gave yourself a 3 or 4, there's a sheet for extra practice you can take home." It's self-monitoring when students reflect intentionally on their own level of mastery. It's a good thing, generally, and there are lots of ways to encourage it in the classroom. For example, asking them to reflect as you ask targeted questions, such as, "I'm going to ask you some questions now to get a sense of how ready you are to go on. If you're not getting all of these questions, it's a sign that you may need some extra practice. In that case, please come see me." See it in action, clip 1. Want to see Amy Youngman in action? Watch Amy as she collects data on student mastery by quickly scanning each student's answer. Of course, deliberate self-monitoring can be worked into a lesson in other ways, building synergy with effective CFU. You could, for example, take self-report, a yes or no question asking students to subjectively evaluate their mastery, and replace it with a session in which you give students time to look back at work they've done and select areas where they have questions. In doing this, you'd probably want to use language that assumes there are questions. For example, what questions do you have? I'll give you some time to go back and look over the last 5 problems. You might even then help them reflect by saying, you should know what I mean by anaerobic, and if not, should be ready to ask about it. You'd probably want to do this activity consistently over time to allow students to build proficiency. Assess by asking objective questions. After a round of guided practice, and just before she released her students at Newark, New Jersey's North Star Academy to a period of independent practice, Katie McNichol asked students to identify problems they'd like to review. At first glance, this might not seem atypical in any way, and perhaps not much different from self-report. But how Katie approached the moment was critical. A sample of hands went into the air, and Katie called on several students. She did not rush. Her message, I am making time for this, and I take it seriously. It is not perfunctory. A student named Youssef asked her to explain what distributing was. Great question, Katie responded. She asked the student to define the term, and then added her own clarification, giving an example. Youssef was still confused, however, so Katie chose an example from her packet for a classmate to tell Youssef specifically how to do this problem. After the explanation, she responded to the student, do the second one for Youssef, and then Youssef is going to do the third. In Katie's hands, then, self-monitoring involves students, 1, identifying specific content they struggled with, rather than evaluating whether they got it, 2, having sufficient time to engage in reflection with the expectation that there would be questions, and 3, reviewing, practicing, and being accountable for answering correctly. Youssef ultimately had to show mastery, not just say he felt better about distributing. This sort of self-monitoring, which ends with objective assessment and requires a significant investment in time, is highly valuable, but expensive from a time perspective. For that reason, it's important to make use of the next technique, targeted questioning, to replace self-report at a lower transaction cost, the amount of resources it takes to execute an exchange, be it economic, verbal, or otherwise. This allows you to save self-monitoring for times when it's most important and valuable. Technique 2, targeted questioning. Ask a quick series of carefully chosen, open-ended questions directed at a strategic sample of the class and executed in a short time period. If Technique 1 focuses on rejecting self-report, you might ask, what do I embrace instead? One of the simplest and most valuable answers to that is targeted questioning. A quick series of carefully chosen, open-ended questions directed at a strategic sample of the class and executed in a short time period, often a minute or less. Using targeted questioning might mean replacing something like this. Teacher, okay, now that we've reviewed cellular structure, is everyone clear on the differences between plant and animal cells? With something like this. Teacher, okay, so let's make sure we're clear on the differences between plant and animal cells. Jason, what does the presence of a cell wall tell me about the cell I'm looking at? Good. And what else might tell me I was looking at a plant cell, Charlene? And which cells have chloroplasts, Jose? Yes, and why do they have them, Sasha? Good. It sounds like we're ready to move on. Ideally, you might choose a few key points of transition in your lesson, 2 or 3 maybe, and plan in advance to insert a round of questions at each one. Even though this might appear likely to add time to your lesson, it's usually faster in the long run, because getting it right before you move on is more efficient than circling back later. It's important to note that the goal of your targeted questions isn't to be comprehensive. The goal is to take a small, brief data sample where previously no data existed and ascertain something about the general level of knowledge in the room. There's a temptation for every teacher to take something that's quick and dirty and make it better. This is one case where you'll want to resist the temptation. It's better to be quick and bring data to multiple places in your lesson by making fast, frequent, strategic guesses than to be comprehensive and exhaustive, but infrequent. The perfect is the enemy of the good. The following rules of thumb may be helpful. Speed counts. Delivering targeted questions should usually take less than a minute or two. The primary goal of targeted questioning is to gauge understanding accurately, of course, but speed is relevant because teachers who can gauge mastery quickly can frequently check for understanding throughout their lessons. Teachers who can ask targeted questions quickly and efficiently are able to incorporate them into lessons on a consistent basis, without breaking the flow of their instruction or dramatically changing their desired lesson plan. In other cases, you will of course use more thorough tools for checking for understanding, but in this case, quick is what we want. Plan questions in advance. For most teachers, asking questions with precision and efficiency requires thinking of them in advance. Planning questions not only makes them more precise measures of what you taught, but also frees you from having to think of your next question on the spot. You can move through questions more quickly, listen more closely to student responses, and, in turn, track patterns or trends in student mastery, perhaps even tabulating them. Planning your questions in advance also allows for more precise word choice, which leads directly to better, more revealing questions. In addition, once the lesson is over, having these questions scripted into your plan makes it much easier to reflect on and sharpen your questioning skills. Did they work the way I asked them? An advantage that can steepen your learning curve over time. Scripting your questions in advance makes it easier to also script the answers you'd like to hear from your students. This clarifies what you're looking for in a correct answer and helps you anticipate and plan for likely errors. For the majority of teachers, there are few steps more useful than considering two questions. What are the mistakes I'm likely to get? And what could I do about it if I got them? Planning how to respond to potential mistakes makes it more likely that you'll take action should they occur. Sample strategically. When you ask targeted questions, you can maximize how much you learn by being intentional about choosing to whom you direct questions. Ideally, in asking 5 or 6 questions, you'd call on your best guess of a statistical sample of the students in the room. 2 students who are usually around the middle, 2 perhaps who tend to take a little longer to master the content, perhaps 1 high flyer. Calling on a group of students who more broadly reflect the spectrum of skill in the class gives you a sense not only of what the students you called on know, but also of what the students you didn't call on likely know. No sample will ever be perfect, but 6 students who represent a plausible cross-section are more predictive of the rest of the class than your 6 most energetic and eager students. Cold call. You'll want to use Technique 33, Cold Call, Chapter 7, to get the most out of targeted questioning. Students who volunteer to answer a question are more likely to know the answer than those who don't. If you take only volunteers when you check for understanding, then your data will always tell you that the news is better than it really is. And because, obviously, the ideal statistical sample won't have their hands in the air exactly when you want them, you'll need to normalize the idea of choosing and calling on less forthcoming individuals, cold calling, in order to see what they know. Be aware, though, that it's important not to limit your cold call only to when you check for understanding. You'll want to cold call long before that, and frequently, so that you normalize it, and students aren't surprised when you use cold call as part of your targeted questions. To truly check for understanding, you need the ability to call on anyone in your class at any time. And to do that, you need to make cold call part of the class's normal operating systems. Track the data. Sampling also offers the opportunity to see responses to your questions as a data set, rather than as isolated individual answers. For example, when I used to ask my students questions in class, I would sometimes get a few wrong answers before a student provided the right one. What's the protagonist afraid of here? I might ask. The first answer wasn't really on target, typically, so I might say something like, not quite. The next answer might be closer, but still not really there. Then a student might repeat part of a previous answer without adding much. Then, finally, the 4th student I called on might give me a high-quality answer. Right, I'd say and think to myself, they finally got it. But, of course, they didn't get it. 1 out of 4 got it. I had imagined a story of progress in a dataset that should have told me the opposite. Wrong, 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 right is not good news, generally speaking. So instead, I want to think of the answers I get as a dataset. What percentage of the group gave a correct or sufficient answer? Was it possible that students used their peers' answers to eliminate some possibilities and guess correctly? Once you've replaced self-report with a sample set of targeted questions, you can make your CFU even stronger by ensuring that your questions, targeted and otherwise, possess two key characteristics, reliability and validity. Reliability and validity. When you use questioning to check for understanding, including targeted questioning, your questions must do a lot of important work in a short period of time. To get the most out of them, you'll want to think about a few topics in question design. Reliability. The biggest danger in assessment is a false positive. You ask a student a question, and he gets the right answer. It appears to suggest mastery, but could it be an illusion? Your student might have gotten lucky and guessed correctly. Or maybe he got one right, but isn't likely to get most right. Still, you heard the right answer, concluded everything was fine, and checked him off your mental list. A false positive like this is dangerous because it's likely to go unaddressed. For that reason, you want to be as sure as you can that the correct answers are also reliable, that they're repeatable and likely to reoccur. One of the best ways to do that is to ask why and how questions that give evidence of the quality of the thinking behind the answer. Another is to ask a question in multiple formats. You want to always ask yourself when you assess, what are the chances they'll get the next one right on this topic? Validity. An assessment is valid if it measures what it claims to measure. In the classroom, validity means ensuring that the difficulty of your questions meets or exceeds the end goal and that you've included enough question variety to ensure that your students will be able to express their mastery no matter the format in which the question is asked. If students answer only multiple choice questions when you check for understanding, for example, your assessment is not likely to be valid. Students are ultimately almost always responsible for open question formats, usually on the test and certainly in life. More subtly, if students almost always answer questions in the one or two formats that are most natural to you, they might not be prepared when they face questions from other sources. It's perhaps obvious to point out that validity implies planning. What's the final standard? Do you derive it from a state test? From the SAT? In terms of college readiness? What's a plausible range of formats students might face? Consider the following three questions about the Stamp Act of 1765. A teacher might check students' understanding by asking any sequence of these questions. 1. What was the Stamp Act? Why was it important? 2. Here is a line from a history textbook. If this new tax were allowed to pass without resistance, the colonists reasoned, the door would be open for far more troublesome taxation in the future. What tax is it referring to? Was the tax allowed to pass without resistance? Explain. 3. What did the Stamp Act propose to do? What governing body passed it? How did the House of Burgesses react? Who led the reaction among the Burgesses? How did the governor of the Virginia colony react? The first question asked for a basic identification of the Stamp Act and a summary of its importance. Pretty good, but the teacher would have no idea how her students would fare if they were asked about the Stamp Act using a different format. The question might allow students to narrate what they know and avoid what they don't know, as some other questions might not. If the SAT asks the question differently, a correct answer to question 1 might not indicate how students were likely to do. Question 2, which asks them to recall the name of the historic event based on a description rather than vice versa, takes a different approach, and combining both in the course of an assessment would give you better validity. Question 3 looks at a broader scope of events and the connections among them. Balancing multiple formats help you ensure that your students are prepared for uncertainty. The demands of reliability and validity require asking a significant number and wide array of targeted questions to check for understanding, enough to establish that students aren't guessing, that they can tell you why, and that they can apply their knowledge in several formats. This need makes another strong argument for cold call, technique 33, and for asking small, quick batches of questions multiple times throughout a lesson. You can question students much more quickly when you don't have to wait for hands to go up. In many classes we've watched, teachers spend only a minority of their CFU time on actual questions and answers. Instead, they spend much more time than is necessary, and then they realize, waiting for students to raise their hands and exhorting, cajoling, reassuring, and narrating it all back to them. I'm seeing the same three hands. I want to hear more of you. Or, this is going to be on the test tomorrow. The result is a process that takes twice as long as it should. Want more? Clip 12. Want to see more targeted questioning? Watch Shadell, Noel, in clip 12. Technique 3. Standardize the format. Streamline observations by designing materials and space so that you're looking in the same consistent place every time for the data you need. The second means of real-time data gathering in the classroom is through observation. One major benefit of observation is that it allows you to respond quickly to more complex ideas and formats of thinking than you can assess through questioning alone. Another benefit is that you can parallel process. You can be checking for understanding while students are working, and this is highly efficient. You could, for example, quickly observe the quality of ideas and expression in your students' thesis paragraphs as they are writing them. That would be both efficient and revealing, and doing so suggests the final benefit of observation, that it allows you to check in on almost everybody in the class if you do it well. Gathering data in the midst of instruction is almost always subject to significant time constraints. Say you assign independent work to students for 5 minutes. By the time you've given everyone a chance to get started and have checked to make sure they're underway, you might have 2.5 minutes to assess 30 students, 5 seconds per student. If you can gather information 3 times as fast, with half as many distractions, you suddenly become able to gather data in situations where you weren't previously able to. In other words, if you reduce the transaction cost of data gathering, you will be able to use it consistently and intentionally without redesigning your lessons. And it allows you to better manage part of your lesson, independent student work, that often goes unmonitored. Standardize the format is one of the most powerful tools for streamlining data gathering and making your observation more efficient. It means designing materials and space so that you're looking in the same consistent place every time for the data you need. You might ask for work to be shown in the margin of a specific page of your students' books, for example, or for students to mark up a page in a specific way. Or, at the beginning of class, you might give students a packet, see Technique 19, double plan, in which to do key aspects of their work that day, and include clearly visible, preset places to write or take notes. In Dave Jaskiewicz's packet from his study of Lord of the Flies, with his 7th graders, for example, the first thing you'll notice is that Dave's students write a ton about really ambitious topics. But as they write, it's easy for Dave to assess them, because every paper looks the same. At a glance, he can scan for the key point. Using a packet like Dave's would mean that as you circulated around the room, you wouldn't have to spend time flipping through students' writing saying, let's see where your paragraph about chapter 3 is, to find what you wanted. In addition to enabling you to find answers more quickly, standardize the format allows you to disrupt students less, as you won't be flipping through their work or asking them to help you find answers. Most important, though, is that instead of expending all that energy just finding answers, you can use your cognitive capacity to concentrate on identifying trends among your students' work. In essence, your reflections on their work are no longer interrupted by a series of scavenger hunts. See it in action, clip 2. In clip 2, Megan Ruler of Leadership Prep Bedford-Stuyvesant in Brooklyn systematically collects data on student understanding as she circulates, then uses what she learns to help them succeed. She begins her vocabulary lesson by prompting students to infer the meaning and charge, positive, neutral, or negative, of the word disposition. As soon as students begin, Megan combs each aisle, reading what her students have written. Because she standardized the format of every packet, see useful tools at the end of this chapter, Megan knows exactly where to look. Soon, Megan notices a trend and narrates, I'm seeing a lot that are talking about it having good characteristics. This is actually a neutral word. To address the error, Megan instructs her students to mark the word as neutral and notes that it's not always positive. Soon after, Megan asks students to write a response to the question, why might someone who skips breakfast develop a cranky disposition by lunchtime? Plenty of hands go up, but Megan gently waves them down and responds, guys, you can get started on your own. This frees her up to continue gathering data as she makes her rounds and encourages students to try to do the work on their own before they ask for help. After taking a hand, Megan assigns another writing task. How could you write a caption about this woman's disposition? Again, she circulates, observes some good work, but then spots another misunderstanding. Students are using the word incorrectly. She reteaches by scripting out an example to illustrate precisely how students should use the word, not just telling them it's wrong, but describing and making students practice how to get it right. You could take Megan's and Dave's idea and adapt it to different situations, too. Asking students to place evidence or definitions on either side of a T-chart, for example, so you would be able not only to look in the same place for information, but also to quickly and easily differentiate and compare the two ideas they were tracking. You'd have a standardized place where they made their comparison. I recently tried this myself at a workshop on CFU. The topic was Reject Self-Report, and the activity was a series of case studies. 6 transcripts from classroom situations where a teacher had initially relied on student self-report to assess mastery. Teachers in the workshop were asked to rewrite cases, scripting their questions to better gather data about student mastery in lieu of self-report. Workshop participants were asked to complete several of the scenarios over the course of a few minutes. At the bottom was an additional section where people were asked to identify and rewrite a case from their own experience. The page I provided looked like Figure 1.1. As my team and I circulated, we were able to ascertain the following quickly and easily. How quickly people were working, and how many scenarios they had completed. This allowed us to make a simple but fundamental decision. How much time should we allocate for the activity? Did people need more time? Which scenarios people chose to work on? It was clear at a glance which of the scenarios they'd chosen to rewrite. Each was in its own box of about a quarter page. I could glance over 20 shoulders and know which topics people had found interesting and would want to discuss during the post-activity discussion. It also helped us write scenarios for future workshops. If very few people chose example 5, say, we could replace it. What good ideas and common mistakes we could talk about during the debrief. It was easy for me to look for more evidence of something specific. For example, if I saw something intriguing in one participant's answer to example 3 and wanted to know if it was typical, it was 10 times easier for me to track other people's responses to that example. It was also easy to scan to the final question and differentiate those answers. That is, I wanted to look differently at the scenario of their own experience to get a quick sense of the sorts of settings they were finding applicable. This was easy to do because the answer I wanted to analyze more closely was located in the same place on every participant's paper. I could find it and tell it apart in an instant. People worked for 3 or 4 minutes, and the room had about 120 people in it. But at the end of that time, I had a pretty good sense of what the strengths and gaps in understanding were, and it was mostly due to an apparently mundane design decision. Merely using standardize the format in a very simple way greatly leveraged my ability to understand what was happening in the room. But what if you're not using written material? Standardize the visual field. Consider a video I sometimes use of an outstanding coach running a workshop for a group of 14-year-old soccer players on preventing the turn. The coach explains how he wants players to line up defensively and how they should react to an opposing player with the ball. He models the drill to bring his explanation to life. Then he tells the girls to practice. In my estimation, most of the girls then proceed to do the exercise incorrectly. They practice getting it wrong and thus, you could argue, get better at getting it wrong. To my surprise, the coach continues, seemingly aware that mastery is imperfect, but not noticing the high rate of error. One reason for this, I believe, is the setup of the drill. The girls are working in pairs, but they're facing and moving in many directions. See figure 1.2. Viewing the group as a whole, it's impossible to track an individual amid the swirling movement at left. Would the coach have seen the errors if the girls had lined up in a more predictable pattern at right? Could he have then scanned a simple and predictable place to see the event he was looking to evaluate? I suspect so. Let's apply his on-field experience to the classroom. Think of some of the ways complex visual fields present barriers to data gathering in the classroom. Then think about some of the ways you might remedy them. One approach is to standardize the visual field, to arrange the classroom so that groups are in a predictable visual pattern. This allows you to scan and understand it at a glance. Another might be to add something observable to indicate engagement, setting the expectation that during group discussion you should see knee-to-knee conversations, eye contact, nodding, or other visual signs of engagement. Technique 4. Tracking, not watching. Be intentional about how you scan your classroom. Decide specifically what you're looking for, and remain disciplined about it in the face of distractions. Another important tool in making yourself more efficient and effective at gathering information through observation is to add a healthy dose of intentionality to your looking. In fact, when your purpose for observation is the gathering of data, tracking is a better word for what you are seeking to do than watching. Tracking, not watching, means deciding specifically what you're looking for and remaining disciplined about it in the face of 1,000 distractions. It sounds mundane, but it's far from simple. By definition, few people are aware of what they don't notice, or that you can, in fact, decide what to notice. Moreover, we're inclined to think that noticing more things is better than noticing fewer things, but that's often not the case in the classroom. In my first teaching job, for example, I knew to circulate around the room and observe when my students were doing independent work. I believed I was very observant as I did so. On my best days, I would circulate as though looking at a blank canvas, waiting to be struck by observations about students. There's a pastiche of quirks and color to observe in student writing, and it was truly fascinating. But what I noticed was often a random event. Therefore, what I gave students feedback on was also likely to be random. If on any given day there were 10 really important things you could say about students' writing, I might notice something about number 7 on the list, or number 9. The cost was that I wasn't talking about topics 1, 2, and 3 consistently, and sometimes not at all. I wasn't giving students feedback on the most important things because I had not decided to look for them when I observed their work. I was looking rather than tracking, waiting to let chance decide what I saw rather than setting out to look for the most important things, even if it meant hunting them out through the thickets of my students' writing. Great teachers are more likely to track, perhaps not every time they circulate the classroom, but more often, especially when they want to check for understanding. If those great teachers had been in my shoes, they'd have asked themselves what they wanted to see the students doing. Whereas my internal narrative was often something like, okay, Brandon's working hard, good, and Sarah's working hard. Wes seems a little stuck, though. A better teacher's internal narrative might sound something like this. Okay, Sarah found her evidence, but she dropped off in a full quotation without the partial paraphrase needed to weave it in, whereas Travis found the subtle evidence, and he's woven the quotation into his...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.